Hello.
All right. All right, I think we're going to get started with this panel. So before we dive in, I just want to get a feel of who's in the room. So can you raise your hand if you are an entrepreneur or founder of a startup? Okay, keep your hand up if you've been in an accelerator or are currently in one. Okay, cool. How many people are investors, if any? Okay. Is anyone working at a company looking to collaborate with an accelerator, like a larger company? Okay. Cool. Very cool. So my name is Sherry Hu. I am a media and entertainment writer for Forbes, and I focus on music and technology. And I'm very excited to be moderating a panel with these two very experienced people working in accelerators and in the investing world. So to start off, can you guys just introduce yourselves and then discuss the wide range of work that you've done with accelerators and with startups, just so people get a feel.
Hi, everybody. I'm Vincent Favrat, the CEO of cognitive technology company MusiMap, which is revolutionizing music recommendation based on the humanized algorithm. There is a slight echo that is making it difficult for us to speak. I think it's okay. So I've invested in five companies, so it's a portfolio logic. And these are companies specifically in the creative industries. I have only one of these companies that is involved in an accelerator. And for me, the key question is to know if an accelerator is slowing company down or if it's accelerating them. And I'm really happy to discuss this different theme with you today.
Thank you, Vincent. It's a really psychedelic experience up here. There's an echo in the back and I'm hearing you. Anyway, everyone, thank you for coming over to this panel. I work with an accelerator in Berlin called EuropeanPioneers. And I'm thinking of, can you still hear me if I talk like this? It's so much better. It's like,
it's really difficult. It's very psychedelic. We have ears that are growing on trees. It's not an easy one.
So I'm based in Berlin. There are probably 20 or 30 accelerators in the city. And this is an important question. European Pioneering, we've worked with 25 startups over 2 years. The focus there was user testing. And in the process of testing products from startups, we looked at partners who would be good for our media startups, for example, agriculture startups, and we partnered with a music label in London to do startup testing there with some of our media startups. That label is called MarathonArtists, and they started a program called MarathonArtists LABs, where they are testing products with startups. You want me to hold this up here? Okay.
Oh, no.
Okay. So, bear with me, guys. This is like, I'm getting used to this now. I think it's really important to look at this from the perspective of what's in it for the startup. And we've in everything I've done, it's been very much focused on product development, what helps accelerate that, what helps make that better. And I hope to talk about that a bit more. Some of the teams I work with are actually in this room right now, so they can be good witnesses to whether or not this process works. So yeah, that's me in a nutshell.
All right, great. Thank you, guys. Hello? Okay. So first, I just want to throw some numbers out there so you guys get an idea of like how successful accelerators are. I guess, as you guys all know, the startup world is there's really high risk. And in a study from TechCrunch, nearly 70% of startups are either nearly out of business or completely out of business within just 3-4 years. But the ones that do succeed have multi-million dollar exits and they're doing really well. So it's very high reward too. And so I think as with any startup in general, it's very important to think about whether an accelerator is good for you. And at this stage of your company, can you really benefit from the network that an accelerator can provide? So I guess that's my first question. Given that a startup is already in an accelerator, how can they make the most out of it so that when they leave or maybe go on to the next one that they are most prepared? Yeah.
So in an accelerator, I think you should treat accelerator as a network opener. There's a bunch of people in there whose job it is to essentially open doors for you. And there are different formats. So the program I worked with, it was 8 months with a large grant. We didn't take any equity in the companies, and we focused on user testing. And what that meant was, literally, if you're a music startup, we would talk to potential clients or brands to see what they thought about what you're doing and set up meetings with them. And those same people could become your customers. And so as an accelerator, our task was to be that node for the startups that opens up as many doors as possible by any means necessary to help the startups. The startups can do that too. It's just sometimes it helps to have an intermediary, a third party, calling up on your behalf because they have a brand associated with them, with startups. And this was an interesting process for me because we were talking to many different companies on behalf of our startups. Some of them were food retailers. And this, we have an agri-tech startup that ended up piloting with one of the leading wholesalers for food in the world. And in Germany, that's a pretty big deal. So I think accelerators serve a role to help the startups find customers and business partners, but also validate their assumptions about the market they're in. And in Berlin, we're quite fortunate because we actually live in an ecosystem that's been growing very quickly over the last few years, that startups are not an alien thing to a lot of companies anymore. Many of them are very interested in working with them. And the same thing occurs in London as well. I think the program we're partnered with MarathonArtists in London, that's entirely focused on business development. And startups like Funtoad, for example, who have an experience on mobile, we help them find artist managers, music managers who'd be interested in trying out this experience with their fans. In the same way that the label there focuses on getting customers for the startups, if you look at what we're doing here right now at Sonar, Sonar+D, the startups are on that side, and there's a whole bunch of people on that side who are professionals in the music business and users of their products. I think it's actually a really great format. I actually think this is quite a good accelerator format to actually go out there and talk to your potential customers and show them what you have and see what they think about it. Yeah, in essence, I tend to really look at the product development and what the needs are. And a lot of time, it's getting clients, getting customers, getting users. And how do you go about doing that? And you need to have a team that's pushing that in the accelerator. And that is useful to startups who are at a certain stage where they have something to show, or they're trying to develop an idea that requires that sort of intense feedback.
I think you are lucky enough to be based in Berlin. So am I. Berlin is a particularly exciting hotspot because 2.1 billion have been invested in the Berlin startup scene last year, which shows that it's very, very healthy. I think in Europe we have 600,000 startups and 300 accelerators, a bit less. The point is the number of accelerators is growing, so it's the number of good startups, of high potential startups, is a bit diminishing if there are too many accelerators. And the point is to understand if these accelerators can play a major role in helping companies to succeed. I had a number of a recent study that I thought was quite interesting, which showed that 2.1% of incubated or accelerated startups did make it to an exit of $5 million+. 2.1%. This is not a lot. Then the question could be asked, are these startups reaching these great exit numbers because they are great startups or because they were accelerated? So for me, the question is a bit, sometimes the companies tend to think that they, the investors have to choose them. And I like to think of the question reversed. As an entrepreneur, what type of investors do you want to accompany you in the journey that is a long journey with a lot of hurdles to reach your milestones and to reach success? And I think part of the success of companies is related to who the investors are. If an accelerator is doing a great job helping them to you know, opening high-level contact, as you meant, mentoring them, pushing them in the media, in the press, opening doors, it's great. For me, there are a few questions that entrepreneur could ask to accelerators. First, is it an accelerator that is generalist, or is it focused on a specific niche, on a specific market? For example, the creative industries, it's a very special industry. A generalist accelerator might not have the right contacts, the industry partner to push the startup in this field. Also, is the accelerator sustainable itself? How many success stories did the accelerator generate? And based on that, it's an important decision to take, because on average, the deals, it's 5 to 10% stake in the company. For a pre-seed amount from 10 to 25,000 euro, which is not a lot, so you give shares of the company, significant share, and then you have to make sure that this investment you make, the entrepreneur makes an investment also in the accelerator, is worth it. Accelerator, in average, they are 3 months, I think. Yours doesn't take equity, and it's 8 months, so I think it's a very good one to tackle for companies.
Those are very good points. Actually, you know, when you look at how many accelerators there are right now in a city like Berlin, you kind of get the feeling like accelerators are over. This thing is far too overplayed. Generalists versus focused accelerators. So the program in Berlin, I was fortunate to work with 25 startups across a wide spectrum of areas. And you could argue that this was a generalist accelerator. I think what really helped us was right now, there are a lot of companies that create an innovation layer where they want to actually talk to startups and do things with them. And this allows us to actually jump that hurdle. Without actually having the network connections, you can actually, 1 or 2 degrees separated, probably find someone who can connect you to those people because you are in the startup space and they want to be in the startup space. So you either know them or you're connected to them somehow. And that opens up the doors quite easily in an ecosystem where this thing is prevalent. I think in areas where you don't have such a strong ecosystem and it's still developing, accelerators might have a role to play in actually supporting that development. But I think in Berlin, you don't actually need to go to an accelerator. You can actually achieve many of your goals by being quite savvy in terms of what you do. And the same goes for London. When it comes to specialist accelerators, so the creative businesses, creative industries, it's really interesting when I looked at this, because for many years trying to get startups to work with the music world is quite a challenge. Tech startups and artists are like two opposite ends of spectrums, both very creative but in very different dimensions. And so the idea behind setting up something at a music label to work with startups took about, conceptually, probably about 4 or 5 years trying out a few things, and the label is about 3 or 4 years old right now. And so the timing was just right to set something up, which is very focused on looking at the challenges the label had. So I can see Nick from StageLink is here. They're also one of the startups in that program. And they started out in Berlin working, Nick would probably describe differently, but they would help artists determine where their fans are. So you just put a link up on Facebook and basically say, where would you like me to play? And they give you feedback on where that place is and how much you want to charge. Now, all of a sudden, the artist gets a ton of data on where they should be playing and where their fans are, and they can reach out to them immediately. Now, the issue was that the music world, as in my interpretation, wasn't ready for this, and it was quite challenging to get the deals done with them or get artists to use it. But they found a lot of success with talent outside of music, comedians and elsewhere. And then the magic sauce is when they tapped into YouTube, and there was a ton of talent there, and you just saw their revenues go through the roof. So when discussing what they could do, one of the ideas was to work with Marathon Artists to actually open up the UK market for them. And you can talk to Nick about this, what his experience is, but I think they're much more open to this conversation now. And when you explain to them this concept of data around your fans and how you can plan tours, and it comes from a music label that has, you know, strong roots in the indie world, and it's quite new and it's very forward thinking. It's probably one of the most forward thinking labels on the planet right now. I think that really opened up doors and really helps. And then that's the UK launch for these guys. And likewise, I think with Funto, a specialized accelerator really helps bring the right crowd to really understand how this technology can be used in an audience. It could be venue owners, could be artists, could be music managers who are touring, and see, you know, their acts really love to have audience interaction on mobiles. And maybe this could be another layer that they could add on. So you're right, you need those connections, and there are specialized ways of doing it. The challenge with the specialized approach is you need to have the company that has the contacts or the network that has the contacts. And developing a program around that doesn't mean you do a three-month accelerator, in my opinion. You have to do something a bit longer because they have an existing business to run. And if they want to work with startups, they have to carve out some time in the month. So we have a very unique structure to the program there to make that happen. It's literally 1 week a month in London. So that's one. And then there's the one in Berlin, which is what you would call a generalist accelerator in a city which is full of startups and a strong ecosystem. And we ran it over 8 months. And we literally knocked down and opened up doors everywhere. We had startups from all over Europe and Israel that we had to work with. And they were not based in Berlin. They were based in their own cities, and we would be working with them from Berlin. So it was pretty interesting. And so we develop knowledge and expertise and networks by doing this that we can add to on the next iteration when we do the next program. So it keeps getting better and better, in my opinion.
Cool, great. So there are two things that I'm thinking of in response to what you guys just said. So one is the difficulty of balancing experimentation. So you mentioned StageLink, which sort of transitioned from the music industry to working with YouTube creators, right? Which is pretty big change. The balance between experimentation and focus, because all startups that are successful, if you ask them, you know, what's one important thing to keep in mind, it is focus. Like, only focus on making one part of the world really good. So I guess, what advice would you give for, balancing the two and managing, the work that you're doing so that it's not too spread out.
Just do maybe a remark on the potential conflict of interest. If you try to stay focused as an entrepreneur, you have a precise roadmap and objectives you have to reach. And accelerators, they are of different kinds. There are three main types, I guess. It's venture-backed accelerators. It's these venture capitalists that are basically doing seed investments to foster companies so as to have more choices, of investment in the future. You have government-backed accelerators, and their goal is to bring great startups in their ecosystem, in their environment, in their places. And then finally, you have corporate-sponsored accelerators that wants to tackle a specific research issue, or that basically wants to develop a specific ecosystem. And there might be some conflict of interest between the roadmap of the entrepreneur and the interest of the accelerator. Let's say if you have a great startup in music tech, which is a case of Mod, a company, great, fantastic company, a disruptive company in effects, music equipment that I've invested in, they decided to move to Berlin because they wanted to be in the music tech ecosystem, and Berlin is the odd place. There is Ableton, there is Native Instrument, there is SoundCloud. That's the place to be and to connect with the right scene. Now, if they had some incentive from Barcelona or from other places, would this have been the right solution for them to go there? You have to decide where the place is the right place to be. And if you need some mentoring, then you go for it. You go in an accelerator, you get what you need, and you get to the next stage, get to the next step. I was asked, for example, with Musimap to go to Sound City in Denmark for this Next Step Challenge, which is one of the most ambitious programs in Europe, backed by Bang & Olufsen. And in the last round, I asked myself the question, do I want to be living for 1 year in Sound City? That is in the middle of Denmark, and it's not fitting, the standard. What I need to do for my company, I should be running, doing the fairs, doing the internationalization phase, and not being stuck in the middle of nowhere. Even though the program was really, really exciting, And they did not select us at the end, so it was a win-win situation. But I really asked myself, you know, is it the right decision to take?
Yeah, the product focus question is a very good one. Because in my experience, this process of working in an environment where you are interacting with other people producing products, or in an environment where there are other startups, means that you get sanity checked a lot, and a lot of people criticize what you do, or in the best interest, obviously, to just say, you know, is this going to work or not? And much of the time, the things improve or change completely. I was just thinking of one of the startups I worked with last year. They did a VR app, and they're called Splash VR now. They actually had a different name when they started. It was called Viorama, and they were people. There was a guy who was a theater director who met up with two really cool techies in a VR meetup, and they decided to experiment with storytelling through VR. And in the process of doing that, they were doing stuff in this theater where they were getting people to do out-of-body experiences so I could live in your body and you in mine, that kind of stuff. It was pretty cool. And then they just got good at creating these short pieces of experiencing an environment in a space. And then the innovation departments of travel companies started to approach them and say, hey, why don't you create content for VR headsets that we could put into our business lounges or on our airplanes and things like that. And it was a really cool idea at the time, back in February, March of last year, to be approached in this way to do that kind of stuff. So they started to go down that route, and then I met them as they were developing this, and they discovered because the process of content production in VR is ridiculously hard. It's like there's so many variables, and you have to hack things together to make it actually look good, feel good, sound good, etc. And so in the process of trying to make this stuff work, they actually invented a way of doing it on your mobile, capturing a VR moment. And stitching four videos together, which was the initial product that they showed me. And then they joined my accelerator in Berlin, European Pioneers, and they had to make a decision. Should we go down the route of selling content to companies like these airline companies, or should we focus entirely on a mobile app and just really go for this crazy, mad consumer gold rush of VR? They went for the second one, and they developed the product. We spent a lot of time debating this, and you know, they won South by Southwest, the accelerator tracked when they presented what they had. So you could argue they got lucky, but I think what the process of actually getting to the point where they made a decision on this was driven by an inherent challenge in content production that meant for them, as people who wanted to share stories and tell stories to people through this medium, they felt it was completely limiting. And the mobile phone is quite liberating in that sense. You could record this moment we're having right now and post it to Facebook. They are the first app to do that. I think it's the accelerator gives you the space to challenge your assumptions. I wouldn't say it's exclusive to what they do. Sometimes some programs, many of the programs, are around 3 months long, and they're that length for a reason. It's actually a really good run to actually just push to get your product in one direction if you know what that direction is, or kill it completely and decide what you should be doing. So this can take on different forms, whether it's 3 month or 8 month accelerator, but I think it's good to have that feedback from people around you to actually help you make the right decisions, which you may be proven wrong in time, but most of the time it tends to work out. Having said that, you don't need to be an accelerator. I think if you're in a city where you're surrounded by startups, like your startups moved to Berlin, I think being in that ecosystem really helps. When I lived in London back in 2008, there was an ecosystem, but it wasn't what it is. You look at it now, you think it's always been there. It didn't really exist. It took about 2 or 3 years to really, really kick off. And the same thing happened in Berlin. 2 or 3 years and it kicked off. And I think this is happening in many other cities. And slowly but surely, you are surrounded by peers. The sophistication levels of like product development goes up. And you see better things percolating to the top. And so the accelerators get to, you know, get the best stuff in the end. So that's also a good thing.
Just to rebound on this, I think it's a very key idea or important idea for me, what you have described in terms of experimentation. I think accelerators are there to develop prototypes, to challenge the idea, to find the right partners, to help on the strategy, define a roadmap, and that's really key. If a company is more advanced in its development, it might not be the right way to go, in my opinion. But I would like to give one example. I have a company called Just Temptation, which is the continental Europe leader in film music investment. We had a nice idea. We had made a few cases, financed three films, and we found a strategic investor, a business angel or a super angel, that was leading the market in digital screens and projectors and servers in cinema around the world. That was a very key strategic partner. Invested 20,000 first. And of course, we were excited because we could, from the market proof, grow and gain market shares. But what happened is that we reached the milestone, and this investor invested 60,000, and then 120,000, and 360,000. And now we are discussing with him of an investment of 1.3 million on 3 years. So sometimes what you see, if you have the right financiers, is not the 21,000 that is important. Is the way that this journey will lead, will take you to, if you do reach your milestone, if trust is, if you are able to provide your investors with trust and you reach your milestone, then they can invest more, they can open doors and bring you high-level clients in the market. And I think that's very important, be it from an accelerator or from a strategic business angel or super angel.
Yeah, it's really interesting to hear that story of how you started out just with a $20,000 investment, because I feel like there's also a pressure now to just grow as quickly as you can and then have, multi-million, even a $1 billion exit in just like a year or two. But I think managing expectations in that way is really important.
Because I think that's quite key because, so first on the valuation, you were mentioning that. If you pitch your company to investors saying it has a valuation of 70 million euro and you want to raise 20 million, you better back your assumption. Sometimes people think it's good to be ambitious and to show big numbers. For most of the investors I know, it's a no-go because the entrepreneur doesn't know his field. It's not realistic, so it will be too much an hassle to go to a result. Then, if you raise a significant amount of money with a venture capitalist, for example, this will impact the way your business is run. They will push you to make an exit in the next 1 year, 2 years. And if you want to grow your SME into a profitable 30, 40 employee company, this will, this might lead to a clash because it's not what you want. You don't want to exit to a big player. So it's also a question that you have to ask yourself. I think in the creative industries generally, there is a problem of, evaluation of the IP. How do investors, knowledge of the market first, because it's a complicated market, it's intangible assets, it's difficult to evaluate the IP, and the market or the numbers are very small. Normally in the creative industries, mostly you ask for 50, for 100,000, as some banks or venture capitalists are looking at things starting at 3-5 million. So there is a real problem in terms of size. So I think accelerators and business angels are a good way to go beyond this friends and family first round and to go to seed investment with the right partners. I think one of the other way, the third way, would be crowdfunding campaigns. Because I think they have two advantages. They create a community behind your product, and then they provide you with a semi-market proof. This company mod, that is this effect box that revolutionizes music equipment, so it's replacing most of the equipment that musicians use. It's a box that where you can do limitless chains of effects. It's replacing the computer. It's an operating system inside of the box. This company made a quick starter campaign. They had 250 backers. They raised 100,000 euro in a crowdfunding platform. And that allowed them to have feedback from the user. They were connected to the market. They could move forward. They have made 4 prototypes. Now they are market ready. I met them at Sonar last year. It was part of the competition. And I saw the engineer. It is an engineer CEO that was speaking. He was speaking too technically, so most of the investors did not really get the point. But I really saw the potential of the passion of the entrepreneur, and I trusted him. We worked together to do a proper financing plan, to do a proper business model, and you know, to start raising money, producing 1,000 pieces. That's the stage they are at, and they will scale. And I bet this solution will be a solution that will take about 7 to 10% of the market in a few years' time. So it's a nice success story that starts at events such as Sonar, where there is a clear need from the entrepreneur on strategy, on seed financing, on finding the right, having the right access to the right financier, the right strategic partners to grow, scale, and take the market. And I think that's quite important.
Crowdfunding is definitely a popular route for consumer products, and some very popular apps out there have succeeded in doing this, game apps. It's really about, when you look at crowdfunding, Kickstarter or Indiegogo, any of the other platforms that you decide to use, you have to imagine 6 months of you know, probably 3 months of planning, probably 6 months of planning, just to build up the community around your product and think of your strategy. Many of the successful campaigns I've seen, the ones that were super hits, and I was just fortunate enough to know the founders behind it, I know that they had already raised significant venture capital money and were using this these mediums as a way to market what they do. They had very great PR talent around, marketing talent around the campaigns. And so when these things launched, they were like slingshots. They were written in all the main publications. So like there's this thing called Sense. It's like a device. It's like an alarm clock. I'm competing with those guys next door. it's like an alarm clock that recognizes your sleeping patterns and noises outside and wakes you up at the right time. And they had a hugely successful Kickstarter campaign. I think they wanted to raise $500,000, and it was like a few million in literally hours. And yeah, this was successful because the brain behind it was the guy who did Spotify's launch. and you know, they had a really clear campaign. And this is what I'm seeing more and more in some of these successful campaigns. It's highly engineered by really smart people. And you have to think about it as a route to market, and sometimes you're competing with that kind of campaign effort around your product. There are many issues I have with crowdfunding because a lot of campaigns don't succeed, or the products take forever to reach the public. This is quite well known, but overall it's a really good option if you know how to use it. As a funding tool, I think it's highly risky because of the failure aspect. It doesn't look good to have to engage a community and then your product doesn't go anywhere. So you have to think carefully about the downsides. There are lots of upsides, clearly. Funding, valuation, and all this stuff. Look, Europe, the valuations are always lower than the US. This has always been the case as long as I worked in this space. I used to be in London working with fast growth tech companies and investment banking for a long time. It was always the same. I went to VC, went into accelerators, the same topic. Typically here in Europe, your seed rounds are valued at somewhere up to 1 million for the company. It goes up to 2 or 3 million depending on what you do. And then the Series A, the first significant round you do after you got past that is about 5 million. And then it goes up. Have it in the US, you just double that. Just double that number, and it's this is what I see. I'm just reporting to you deals I've seen. Okay, so everyone has an opinion on this. It's always about what the investor is willing to pay. And I talk about it candidly. I know in the conversations I had with some of the startups I work with, I just say, just add a zero to that valuation you had. That's how much you're worth, and then let's see what happens. But you have to be careful as a startup not to go in there with these false expectations that you know you're worth a lot more. There's got to be a justification for what it is you have. So I know that sounds very vague, but that's the nature of negotiating. Valuation. It's two sides coming to an agreement on what you're worth and what I like to do. If you don't like a number, negotiate around it. You know, just give away the equity and earn it back if you hit your milestones. There are ways to structure deals that deal with some of these issues. I'll hand over now.
I think just a comment on that. I think smart money is much, you know, it's another value that money. I think if you have the right investors, even though your valuation might be a bit below, it's a great investment because it will help you to scale. And the question that you were touching there that is really important, I think, is, you know, where do you scale with the company? Is it Europe? What is the ground? Europe, US? As you said, there is more money in the US. In fact, there is five times more money in the private investment in startups in the US than in Europe. It's a very unified, simple market, as we are struggling in Europe to have a single digital market. I know the European Union is pushing for that, but it takes time. If you know, you analyze the logic of investment, you still, it's unfortunate, but it's still, you know, linked with local, national, logic. So to do cross-border investment in Europe is something we should definitely push. And I think it's a quick key question. How can Europe, you know, retain the talents, nurture them, and make great success stories in Europe that are not bought by US companies as an exit, but where do we also have middle-sized, big-sized player, you know, in Europe, from Europe? I think, you know, Axel Springer in Berlin, or such companies, services, they can afford to, they can invest 300 million, 500 million in companies. We need more of these players in Europe to grow the sector, I think.
I'll just add one more thing to that. What's really interesting about the last 6 months is living in Berlin. So something has changed. There are U.S. investors, early-stage seed funds, actively pursuing investments in Europe. So I think, you know, we've reached a point where this market is being understood a bit better, and the investors overseas are getting braver. And what I find, it's really interesting. So investors in Europe don't invest in some of the companies I work with. And then the US investors say they want to invest in these companies. So those investors go and invest in them. It's a really strange thing to see, but it's happening. And I think there's probably a combination of things happening here. One is investors globally recognizing some of the hot spots in Europe for investment and the talent that's coming out of here, and looking at the technologies that are being created as things that can be scaled up within their local markets, but also internationally because of the distribution mechanism we have. You know, it's the app stores, it's the way you distribute through online, and also I think more people see digital as much more of a unified world, even if the European Union is trying to catch up with that. It's like the products themselves sell themselves. So I think something's changed in these sort of perceptions at the seed stage, which is quite interesting. I certainly did not anticipate that to happen, because seed stage is a very chemistry-driven thing. You got to like the person as an investor and believe that they could be the ones to take this company forward or turn it around if it all goes tits up. Because it typically does, you know. It's like 90% of these things fail. Accelerators try and bring that down to half of them will continue to work afterwards. So, something's improved in terms of sentiment, but certainly in the last 6 months, I've seen a lot of leadership from the U.S. early-stage investors really backing companies in Europe and bringing in seed rounds with, you know, multiple investors in Europe with them. It wouldn't happen the other way around, which is really weird, but hey, that's how these things are.
I think just one point on this. I think, you know, there is also great things that Europe can offer. We have this battle, US, are US investors investing in Europe? How this constellation is working? But I think we have also interesting tools that are maybe not so in use in the US. For example, semi-public bodies. With this company MusiMap, so cognitive technologies company, it's really this intelligence assistant bringing you the right context, content at the right time according to your personality, your mindset, your emotions, in your social context. We did raise money from French and Flemish investors, and then we leveraged that with the semi-public body. In this case, it's Meusinvest in Liège, and it's Start in Brussels. So it doubled the cake. And then with this money, we developed the company right. The valuation went up a lot. I think 8 times now in 2 years, which is great. I'm very happy about that. And we came to this point. To which extent are we market driven and just closing deals and license to survive and to move the technology forward, or can we afford to take a step back and to choose the right partners in the market so that, you know, the roadmap is better, the valuation is higher, and it's a healthy company. And these semi-public bodies allowed us to have a convertible loan afterwards to do the follow-up, which means we had this room to choose the right partners to close the first deal. Now we have three deals, important deals closed, including Quant, the search engine, so the competitor to Google Google search engine, and also with Cobbers, which is the leader in high-resolution streaming in Europe. And these are perfect partnership for us, and we had these opportunities because of the European way of funding. So maybe you get less, but you might get a quality investment at the right time to grow the company organically with to fit your roadmap and not too aggressive on the venture capital side.
Cool, very interesting. I sort of want to veer off from that and talk about this. I think there's like a very recent trend of accelerator hopping, where like startups just go from one accelerator to the next and they sort of get trapped in this cycle of like always relying on these very structured programs to secure funding and to build a product. I was wondering what you guys thought of that. Is it like a good idea, bad idea?
It happens. Well, you know, if you're a startup, you need to raise money, and sometimes that process can take time while you're developing your product. You got to keep your team together. And we just happen to be in a time where there's more and more of these programs that support startups popping up everywhere. Sometimes, most of the time, they call them accelerators, but there are also loads of grant mechanisms in Europe where you could tap into if you're a creative startup. I've just discovered this in the last few weeks. I didn't know they existed. But it's, you know, there's lots of ways to ensure that you keep moving forward. And that is sometimes the biggest challenge at the early stages, keeping a team together as you do this and validate what it is you're doing. So I think it's okay to accelerate. The thing is, what you got to keep in mind, many of these programs are about 3 months long. So in that time, you make a lot of progress, and then at the end of it, it just goes quiet. You know, this is just the nature of this such programs. So if another accelerator comes along and says, hey, we'd like you to join our team, and keep in mind, it's a competitive process to select the best startups. Sometimes you do see hopping, but hopping can go from being in a generalist accelerator that is good at, you know, pushing startups to a stage where they can market themselves confidently and attract investors, to the point where they join a corporate program or a very focused music program. And this happens. I think, you know, Nick from StageLink was at Techstars in Berlin, and then he joined the program in London. So I didn't think of that as hopping. In fact, I think it's so normal now to go from like multiple services that help you get your product to market or into the right hands, the right partners. So I don't see it as a bad thing, but because it's getting more sophisticated. I think a couple of years ago, it was a trend to just hop from one accelerator to another in some of these cities because there were so many accelerators popping up, and they needed to get startups on board. That it was quite funny to see. But in many ways, those companies survived that by doing this, and those entrepreneurs went on to actually do different products later, which is great. So I'm quite cool about it. I find it really hilarious to see, like, you know, this, they are literally hopping, but it's a process that goes in parallel with the development of the ecosystem around them. It's whereas at some point, you know, the convergence is when you have investors who see startups that they like and are confident investing them because they understand the market they're in. And in Europe, this takes some time. You know, a lot of social products that are created here, just the investors were not ready for this kind of stuff when I first started doing this stuff. And so now they understand it a bit more, and they're moving away from things that are very clear-cut e-commerce plays into things that have some creative element in them, because that is an important aspect to have in your product and your team. So if you did not have such investors around you, you'd probably have to accelerate a hop until that happened. So it's cool. I mean, you have to do what you have to do to survive. So yeah.
One question I ask myself is, if a startup comes to me with, you know, being part of an accelerator, I'm asking myself, do I take that as a validation of the startup, you know, relevancy? Is it something that is bringing credibility, or is it something that is not? You know, I'm asking also, what is the success rate in accelerators? And most of the numbers I've seen don't look really good on this front in terms of success stories of, you know. So I think it's good to nurture the ecosystem, to train entrepreneurs, also to fail, to test, to fail, to confront to the market, to get that, to get there. I have the impression that it's really interesting if you need, for example, mentoring and strategic advisors. I would go, personally, I would go for a strategic board. I would go to the market and catch the right person to help me out and, you know, propose shares so that they mentor my company towards the success. And I would prefer this option as going to an accelerator. Same thing if I have to have a validation. Of course, an important, well-established accelerator brings credibility. So I think it's great. But I would prefer a validation from the market. For example, for MuseumApp, you know, we went, you know, we were in the top 10 startups, Belgium startups, but geektime.com, national level. Then we went to Slush, we were in the top 20, you know, highest growth potential startups. And then we went to South by Southwest, where we were in the top 20 music startups on the US and worldwide level. And that's a validation from the market, from the fairs, that I would prefer to an important accelerator. Because at the end of the day, it's, you know, as you said, it's the team, it's the vision. You know, you have to have that right, you have to get your prototype right, and then personally I think to go in this lean startup notion that you have to confront this to the market and get signals and improve until you reach the success. So that would be the advice.
Okay, great. I think we're almost out of time, so we'll open it up to audience questions. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you. I don't really have a question. I just wanted to thank you for a very interesting talk. Especially what I found really interesting is when you mentioned the use of crowdfunding platforms as a tool to launch products. I worked for many years at Native Instruments, and I was behind the marketing for launch of many hardware and software products. And so I've been involved in launching products directly to the market. And recently I was snatched up by a startup who asked me to run the marketing for or the launch through Kickstarter, a crowdfunding campaign. And that's when I realized how actually there was very little difference between launching a product for an established company such as Native Instruments and launching a product for a unknown startup through Kickstarter, because these Kickstarter campaigns now have become extremely well orchestrated, and I've found it just as challenging doing a Kickstarter campaign as launching a big product for Native Instruments, and I've been finding it very interesting, this experience of basically having a double launch for the same product. You're gonna launch it through Kickstarter, you're gonna cross your fingers, hope for the best, and reach your goals, double your goal, triple your goal, and then a few months later, you're gonna have to relaunch the product to market, and it's gonna be very challenging, and the role of crowdfunding campaign or platforms is becoming bigger and bigger, and I just found that very interesting. You guys had some very good points, and I found this talk very inspiring, so I wanted to thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
If I may, I just want to say a word about crowdfunding. I think it's not a solution for any types of company. It's really blood, sweat, and tears. It's a lot of efforts to get there, so you have to have the right product for such a launch, I think. If I take back the example of Mod, it's very disruptive. It's an operating system inside of a box. And doing the quick starter campaign helped them to understand the needs of the backers, and they understood the full potential of the technology where they could become an ecosystem. They turned this into a social media where people could exchange FX chain directly in the box. They developed the peripherals stream of revenue, so effect, pedals and different type of things. And, they have really created an whole ecosystem around that. And I think that was key in the process. So you can improve your business, get feedbacks from the base, from the users, and get ideas from the market that you wouldn't have thought before, and maybe increase the value of the company doing so.
I was just reflecting on a couple of campaigns that I found very interesting. One was this app called Run Zombie Run. And it was like a running app, and it, you'd hear zombies chasing you, and you had to run away from them. And the team that created this came from the games world, some really smart folks. And I remember the description of this campaign. You know, they got there. They raised some money from the crowd to develop this product, and it was a huge hit. But they had to manage this community of people who really wanted this product and were in love with it, had so many ideas of how it could be improved. And so, you know, when you're running this stuff right now, I'm sure you're thinking about the community management side of it, which is such a crucial thing, right? You don't want negative stuff, negative sentiment on that feed. And you have to anticipate all these issues. Another one that's really interesting, I forget the name of the product, but it was basically like a book with a whiteboard inside it. It was a really special product. You could just draw things on it and then share. They marketed it like an iPad. They used the iPad sort of like advertising to say it was a book. Anyway, cut a long story short, this was a very successful campaign by a bunch of very creative people in Berlin. They created a product that is looks like a book. You open it up and it's a whiteboard, and they have a special pen you can write on it and you can wipe it off and use it multiple times. They did this entirely on Kickstarter, and they had a successful campaign, built up a strong community around it, released the second version to that community again. They built everything just on this community, and then they had some very interesting partners approaching them, some of the biggest stationary software companies in the world that stores all your texts. They have a store, they wanted to have this product in there. People were just approaching them to get this product out. So they had a great community, loved the product, and they raised money without having a product. So they used that money to do the R&D into materials, find the right manufacturers, make it work in a way so they could produce thousands and then tens of thousands in a scalable way. And the crowdfunding for that product was absolutely perfect. But yeah, the community management for them, it was great because everyone loved them and loved the product, and they shipped on time. You will see a lot of stuff where this doesn't happen, and you are aware of this. That's your worst nightmare, when the community hits back at you, because that's the first thing you see when you go to that campaign. You look at the feedback.
Right. All right. I think that's it for time. So please join me in thanking Kalam and Vincent for this great talk. Thank you. And you guys should stay for the startup competition awards, which are right now. It's very relevant.